today, so I figured we could all just go over to Kirk Monroe's session instead. Yeah, just kidding. So anyway, I'm excited to be here at the summit to spend some time talking with all of you about the cool things that are going on in the realm of PowerShell authoring tools. For those of you who don't know me, I'm David Wilson, and I'm a member of the PowerShell team. And I'm really fortunate to get to work on cool projects like the PowerShell ISE, PowerShell for Visual Studio Code, and PowerShell Editor Services. And in my time working on these projects, I've been able to talk with many members of the PowerShell community. So it's really awesome that I get to meet many of you in person this week. If you see me around the summit in the next few days, please feel free to come by and chat. So my talk today is titled The Future of PowerShell ISE and Editor Services. So my goal with this talk is to show how the future of PowerShell ISE will be defined by the integration of PowerShell Editor Services and how this will improve the larger PowerShell authoring ecosystem. So let's start with an overview of the current landscape of PowerShell editors, just to show how our work fits into the bigger picture. So for many years, Microsoft has been focused on a single editor for PowerShell, the PowerShell ISE. The ISE is considered the standard PowerShell editor for many people, since it comes in box Windows and typically supports all the latest and greatest PowerShell features as they appear. It's simple and understated, but it gets the job done. Its add-on model has allowed for some nice extensions and customizations and integrations with other Microsoft services like Azure Automation and PowerShell Gallery. It's also been extended far past its original feature set by the ISE Steroids add-on, which a lot of people seem to like. Tobias Weltner has done a great job of turning the ISE into a much more powerful editor than what it was before for those who needed it. So even though the PowerShell ISE has been serving people well for many years, a new opportunity appeared last year that we wanted to sort of investigate, and that is Visual Studio Code. So Microsoft announced Visual Studio Code during Build 2015 and spent a lot of time last year polishing it and improving it into something that's really useful. Its biggest benefit over Visual Studio is that it manages to provide the same level of functionality, or close to the same level of functionality, without all the extra bloat that Visual Studio has. So around the middle of last year, we were alerted to the development of a new extension model that would allow developers to plug in new language implementations and functionality like IntelliSense, code navigations, linting, and debugging support. And we decided that it would be cool to investigate to see what it would take to actually plug in PowerShell to Visual Studio Code. Turns out it wasn't that hard to provide a pretty decent level of PowerShell support. So in November of last year, we released the PowerShell extension for Visual Studio Code during the announcement where the Visual Studio Code team announced their extensibility model. And since then, we've had over 30,000 downloads of the extension and 4 updates with new features and a wide variety of great feedback from the community. So this effort also spawned another project called PowerShell Editor Services, which allows us to provide the same level of capability to pretty much any other editor, but we'll talk about that later. So we also have Visual Studio, and people were asking for a long time why Microsoft didn't actually provide PowerShell support directly in Visual Studio. Well, they didn't really need to ask for long because Adam Driscoll came along and made POSH tools for Visual Studio, and it filled a real need for really good PowerShell support in Visual Studio, as demonstrated by the 340,000 downloads it's received, at least for the 2015 version. And the utility of this extension was so obvious that the Visual Studio team decided to include it as part of the Visual Studio 2015 installer. So that was pretty cool. Now, for those who need something a little different than what Microsoft provides, our third-party editor story is still pretty good. There's the PowerShell Studio editor from Sapien Technologies. I think June's somewhere back here. It's a really nice tool that seems to go beyond just a general development experience to user interface development, packaging, and deployment. I've been hearing really good things about it on Twitter, and I haven't really had much of a chance to play with it myself, but I'm sure that June will be happy to tell you more of the cool things that it does. There's also Power GUI, which was originally developed by a company called Quest and then acquired by Dell. And I think that Kirk and Adam had worked on this at some point in the past. I've heard good things about it, but I don't really see much activity for its development these days. And we also have the wild and crazy world of open source code editors. So Sublime Text and Atom are both really popular for developers who primarily use open source technologies and platforms. Their strengths lie in their modern style and wide ecosystem of packages that give support for various different tools and technologies, pretty much anything that you can think of. So for PowerShell, both of these editors provide packages that contain syntax highlighting, snippets, and some really rudimentary IntelliSense, but no real integration with the PowerShell runtime. And last year, I spent a little bit of time, maybe a couple days, trying to get PowerShell editor services integrated into Sublime Text to start to get some of these features online, but I still haven't got it fully wired up yet. But hopefully, at some point later this year, I'll get a chance to go back to these editors and wire them up. However, over the last few months, I've noticed that a lot of people are starting to migrate towards Visual Studio Code, so that may sort of affect the prioritization of the work to wire up these editors. So there's also Emacs and Vim, and the common stereotype for Emacs and Vim users is that they're old school Unix admins with scruffy beards, long ponytails, and stale t-shirts. But the reality is that both of these editors are still widely used today, and there's a sort of a resurgence in their popularity based on some new tools for them called SpaceMax and NeoVim. Both of these editors have packages that provide basic PowerShell editing support, similarly to Sublime Text and Atom. But they also lack the richer editing features like IntelliSense, et cetera. They also have the same sort of extensibility models that would allow those things to be added later. So since I'm actually a fan of Emacs, I want to go and try to get that thing hooked up with better PowerShell support sometime, maybe later this year or next year. And I know there's a couple of people on the PowerShell team that are active Vim users, so I wouldn't be surprised to see some activity there as well. So at this point, you're probably wondering, why am I mentioning all these editors? Well, it shows that there's value in having different options for different needs, basically. So, you know, some people prefer the focused experience of the PowerShell ISE, while others need a more complete development experience like Visual Studio, which supports other languages as well. Some people prefer the minimalistic editors like Vim, or maybe modern, highly customizable editors like Atom. The important thing to understand is that for each of these editors to provide a standard PowerShell development experience, they have to implement a fairly large amount of common code. So what we'd like to do is to make it easier to provide the standard experience across most of these editors so that each developer can work in the environment that's most comfortable to them, that works better for their workflow. So a little later in this talk, I'll describe how we'll be able to accomplish such a standard experience and feature set so that developers have a wide variety of tools to choose from. So since this presentation is supposed to be about the future of PowerShell ISE, let's talk about the ISE preview. We made an announcement a couple months ago that we had shipped an alternative version of the ISE via the PowerShell gallery, which gives us the opportunity to try out some new features and new ideas while keeping the built-in ISE stable. Our intention is to ship updates with new features somewhere between a monthly to bi-monthly cadence. Having said that, you may have noticed that it's been a little while since the first release. I think that we released it in February and still lacking another release since then. That's for good reason, though. I've actually been working over the last few weeks to put together a new release that addresses some of the most highly upvoted feedback on user voice, and also a new feature that I think all of you are going to like. So instead of just showing you a list of what these new features would be, why don't I just give you a quick demo and kind of show it that way. Let's see if I can pull that up. All right. So one of the first things you may notice that's a little bit different is that there's this little icon here in the lower left-hand corner. So now we have the ability, when the ISE preview starts up, to do a scan for any PowerShell gallery modules that you may have installed and to check for if there's any updates to those, because currently there's not a really good way to see which gallery modules you have that may have updates that you haven't installed yet. So I decided to put a little piece of UI here that will give you the information for this. All right. So when I click the icon, there's a new window that appears that gives me a list of the modules that currently have updates. And we can see here that the PSCX module needs to be updated. Of course, this was released in 2015, so you know, it's sort of a contrived example. Also, there's PS Script Analyzer, which has been updated to version 1.5. So you can see that we're actually gathering the release notes and the version information from the gallery information. You can see that sort of all the details are here. Also, you can select whether you want all updates or just, you know, uncheck various updates that you're not interested in. And another interesting thing here is that the PSCX module actually was installed system-wide. It wasn't installed for just the current user. So I'm not actually running the ISE preview elevated right now. So it's sort of interesting to see what happens whenever we do this. So I'm going to go ahead and just click update to update these modules. So since PSEX needs admin level credentials, we actually see an error that sort of shows you. It's basically just the error that comes directly from PowerShell from the commandlet. And also, you'll see that there's a prompt for the untrusted repository, but I think that should change soon. But now it's installing PS Script Analyzer, and if I had other modules that need to be updated, they would all be installed as well. So pretty easy just to install all your updated modules. It's nice for people who actually are module developers, so that whenever you push a new version of your module, people who are using the ISE will actually be able to install it. They'll know that it exists. So since this functionality starts automatically with the ISE, some people may not want to have like the initial performance hit of having this sort of module scan and update scan happening. So we've actually added a new option in the options dialog in the general settings tab. So you can actually uncheck the check for module updates automatically option. So that will stop it from happening at startup. And if you ever want to invoke the process, you can go to the help menu and click check for updates. So that will kick off the update process. So that's sort of the big new feature. There's another thing that we're doing that sort of sets the stage for future work on the PowerShell Editor Services integration, and that is the new experimental PowerShell tab. So if you click the file menu, you'll see that there is a new item for an experimental PowerShell tab. And right now, if you open it, there's really nothing different. It's the same functionality that we currently have. But the point is to have this separate tab so that we can start to gradually do the integration with PowerShell Editor Services over time and not disrupt the core PowerShell ISE experience. This also helps people like Tobias Weltner, who have ISE steroids, and he's sort of reached into the functionality of the ISE a little too much. And if I do anything drastic with the existing PowerShell tab functionality, it's going to break all the ISE steroids users. So don't really want to do that. But in the future, you'll be able to try out new features that come from PowerShell Editor Services in this type of tab. So as those things get developed, I'll be talking about it on Twitter probably and letting people know that that new things are available there. All right, so there's one user voice issue. I think it was filed by Bartek, and it was sort of an annoyance for people, and a lot of people expressed some interest in getting this removed or getting this changed. Let me see if I can pull up the inbox ISE. So right now, if you were to type something like git process, whoops. And you see there's a lot of output. And you want to scroll up in the output pane and sort of see what's going on there. Then maybe you go into the script editor and mess around a little bit. Then you come back and click in the output pane because you want to copy something, but it jumps down to the end, which is a little bit annoying. So now I've removed that behavior. So if we type git process here in the ISE preview, you'll see the same output, a little bit slower because I'm running it in the debugger. And if I scroll up here and click inside of the script editor and mess around and come back, it doesn't actually jump to the end. So it probably needs to be a little bit more polish on this, to kind of deal with a couple of cases where maybe you do want it to jump to the end, or maybe if you click in here, you may want to like hit a button and have it jump to the end. So there's a little bit more polish that needs to be done. But really what I like to do is just sort of ship this and see what people think and just get some feedback from the community and see what people want it to do. So so that's kind of helpful, a little less annoying now. Also, just general productivity improvements. For instance, when people want to like comment multiple lines of code out, what they've been told in the past is, oh, just use multiple cursors. And that's not really the ideal way to do this because most editors give you a way to just select multiple lines and comment them out. So I've been working on a feature that allows you to just do that. So if you select a few lines of code and hit Control-K, it just comments all of them out. And also Control-Shift-K will uncomment them. You may notice that the indentation is a little bit different now. I need to work on this a little bit, but I think that this is sort of one of those core features for an editor that's really necessary that just wasn't there before. And I think the reason why it wasn't implemented before is there's a little edge cases here and there, like detecting whether there's spaces between the comment character, et cetera, that maybe it just wasn't seen as worth the effort. But I think it's worth the effort, so we're going to try to finish that and get it shipped in the next update. Also, another big problem is if you have a file open in the ISE preview And for whatever reason, the file changes on the file system outside of the ISE, there's no notification. It doesn't tell you that it's been changed, so you might start editing your file here again and save it and then overwrite whatever the external changes were. So now I've tried to get the .NET Framework's file system watcher hooked up to solve this problem. So let's see if it works and doesn't crash and burn. So actually, I'll just go ahead and open this file in Notepad, same file in Notepad. And let's see. So I'm going to go and just make a change here in this file. And you'll, oh, let me just undo whatever I did here. So this file is unsaved at the moment. Sorry, it's saved at the moment. So if I go ahead and just add some text here, save it, then you'll see that it, OK. This time it didn't work, but and it crashed. So this is a good time to tell you that .NET's file system watcher is a little unreliable. And this crash may be my fault, but the point is that when this first comes out, it's actually probably going to be a little flaky. So we're going to have to do a little work to see what we can do to make it a little bit more reliable. So actually, I'll give it one more shot and see if it works. And if it doesn't, we'll just move on. It happened again.
Well, hey, at least you can't edit it after another.
Yeah, yeah. So, that's true. Actually, maybe I'll just leave it like this. Yeah, it's a feature, so you know, we'll just restart the session. It's great. We just reload the files, no problem. That's right. That's, you know, you guys should all be my marketing team. I'll just let you guys explain all the problems that we have. That's great. All right, so let me.
I've seen it happen too many times.
Yeah. All right. So let's talk about ISE preview priorities, if I can get back to where my presentation was. Whoops. All right, I don't know what the thing's doing. There we are. So one of the first things I want to do, as you may have seen, is address as much user high-value user voice feedback as I can. I've started this work, but there's still a lot more work to be done. I mean, there's a lot of issues that have been voted up on user voice, and you know, some of them are definitely possible, others not as possible. I mean, there's probably not going to be the likelihood that we're going to, you know, change sort of the UI model of the ISE where you can sort of have docking tabs and stuff just because it's a lot of extra work. I think that ISE steroids may solve that problem already, but you know. Just anything that we can do that would be a general productivity improvement or something that the ISE is lacking that other editors just sort of have by default, definitely file feedback for that. What's up, man?
What about little things like, you know, like maybe after an if statement where you throw your bracket or whatever, you hit enter, you know what I mean? It goes up, double does the line, indents for you. Is any of that kind of stuff coming?
We could definitely look into it. I don't really know how much effort it would take. Definitely worth looking into. So I don't know if there's already a user voice item for that, but if someone files it, we'll definitely look into it.
Find it and upload it.
Yeah, that definitely that.
Visual Studio does.
Pretty much every editor has the sort of automatic indentation functionality. So this is something that is a little annoying whenever you go into the ISE and it just doesn't have things like this. So basically, my plan is to work on the highest value improvements that will address long-term pain points. The goal really isn't to make the ISE at the same level as other editors that exist, because you could just use the other editors instead. But it's just we want to make this like, you know, a really solid core editor with a really good accessibility, so that you know, the community can come and add more features as necessary. So also for new feature development in the ISE. Preview and the full ISE, I'd like to focus on what we can add through the ISE's add-on model to enable new features to be added using our add-on APIs rather than being added into the ISE code base. This may involve just some tactical improvements here and there to our existing extensibility points, but the goal would be to sort of enable new things that people can do to extend the life of the ISE by adding new functionality. This is an area that I'd really appreciate getting some feedback on user voice about what new extensibility points would be helpful. I'm looking for high value, low cost improvements that will enable new types of extensibility in the ISE. There's also a new extensibility model that's coming, which is complementary to the ISE's add-on model, but I'll discuss that a little bit later. So the biggest priority for the ISE is a gradual overhaul that brings in PowerShell editor services as the core implementation for all of its editor features. This integration will be rolled out over time in a way that should minimize disruption to existing scenarios while allowing everyone to try out the new features and provide feedback. So generally speaking, what this means is that PowerShell editor services will basically provide the host environment for PowerShell so that all the things like IntelliSense and code navigations, et cetera, will be coming from there rather than from the existing code base of the ISE. And this will help in some ways because currently we've got some sort of problems with the ISE code base where you might see things like random crashes or hangs and stuff like that that really shouldn't be happening, and it's just due to sort of a bad threading design, et cetera. But we can get away from a lot of those problems by shifting to a different core and sort of refactoring the code that's already there. So as I mentioned earlier, the ISE preview release contains an experimental PowerShell tab, which will be the basis for this conversion. And this new tab will use editor services to basically provide all these features. And since editor services currently doesn't support as many features as the PowerShell ISE does, we'll have to continue to improve that support over time before we actually make the experimental tab the default. So remote sessions is one thing. We don't really support remote sessions yet. There may be some other little things here and there that I haven't thought about. So we'll have to figure those things out sort of as the migration happens. But once we make the experimental tab, actually the default tab, then we'll keep the old tab, the legacy tab, around just to have it there in case anyone hits an edge case in the behavior of the new implementation so that they can use the old style tab for whatever it is they need to do. And ultimately, these improvements should be integrated back into the build of the ISE that we ship with Windows. But we still haven't decided when and how we want to accomplish this, since shipping inbox of Windows requires some extra work around quality, localization, and other types of work. But the current plan is to try integrating new stable features from the preview back into the built-in ISE sometime after the next Windows Server and client versions have been released, so probably later this year sometime, way later this year. We want to make sure that whatever we end up shipping is of high quality and has been put through its paces by the community, just to make sure that it's not going to be a problem when it's actually inboxed and needs to be shipped. Needs to be supported for years and years. So by now, you might have realized that I've mentioned PowerShell Editor Services a few times in this talk, but I haven't actually explained what it is. So PowerShell Editor Services is a platform that can be used to provide a rich PowerShell development experience in any sufficiently extensible editor. The benefits lie in four distinct areas: language intelligence features, interactive console experience, debugging support, and other platform features. So I'll discuss all of those individually. But first, it's good to sort of run through the set of common features that any PowerShell editor will need to implement. First of all, it's going to need a host implementation, which implements PS host, PS host user interface, and some amount of PS raw host user interface. And for those of you who don't actually know what those things are, it's probably better that you don't know. But these allow the host application to expose the PowerShell runtime through the host application's user interface. And they aren't super difficult to implement, but it's a lot of common code that's just re-implemented everywhere, basically. Anytime you want to implement a host, you have to implement these things, and it's kind of a little bit of a waste. So when you start implementing a PowerShell host that does more than just execute PS commands, you'll quickly realize that you have to change the way you execute commands based on the state of the session. Running a command in a local session is different than running a command in a remote session. And running a command while stopping the debugger is also different than running a command just in a normal session. So this behavior isn't always straightforward to understand or figure out. And at some point, any PowerShell host author is going to have to learn how to do these things if they want to have more advanced support in their host implementation. Another critical element of a good PowerShell development experience is interactive console support. So one of the biggest reasons why people tell me they'd still rather use the ISE instead of VS Code is that the ISE has an interactive console that's always available. It's a really helpful feature if you're sort of, you know, really quickly developing a script. Implementing such a console isn't difficult, but it requires rewriting a lot of common logic all over again. For instance, like, you know, invoking the prompt function to get someone's custom prompt, or dealing with formatting of error messages, just all the stuff that sort of has to be done many times. More capable editors may want to provide debugger integration, which requires a fair amount of work for walking the call stack, getting information about variables that are in scope for each level of the call stack, and even managing the pipeline whenever you want to execute commands while the debugger stopped at a breakpoint. So generally, the point I'm trying to make here is that any editor integration for PowerShell is going to need implementations of all of these items. And it'd be great if we could use what we've learned in implementing these things for the ISE and other editors so that we can make this logic available to everyone else. And we just so have created a platform that with the intention of solving this problem. So let's talk about the features that it provides. So for language features, one of the primary benefits is this improved language feature support. First of all, being the IntelliSense support, which is kind of like the core thing you need for, you know, having a pretty good PowerShell development experience in an editor. It's the same IntelliSense that the ISE gets because we're using the same completions engine that comes from the PowerShell runtime. But we also add a new area of features called code navigations. And these allow you to do things like find the definition of a function or variable, find all references of a function or variable or commandlet, and also search across all the names of symbols in your workspace or the current file, which is kind of useful in VS Code. These features turn out to be pretty helpful whenever you're trying to navigate around a piece of code that you haven't ever seen before, or maybe a module. So they're kind of a value add that the ISE currently doesn't have. We also provide rudimentary symbol renaming support, meaning that you can rename a commandlet or a variable, and we'll also change all the places where that commandlet or variable name are used. So that's also pretty helpful. So another really cool feature that we have is that we've hooked up PowerShell Script Analyzer to provide real-time, rule-based script analysis, and we analyze your scripts right as you type. So as you're writing your script, you'll see little squiggle markers that say that maybe you're violating some best practice. So basically, you're able to select which rules you want to apply to your scripts while you're editing them, and then you'll see all the stuff marked up in your file. In the near future, we'll also be able to provide code corrections, which are based on the rules that you've sort of violated. So if you have a squiggle marker under something, you may be able to click it and see a little light bulb that pops up to actually get suggestions on how to fix it. And then if you click the fix, it will fix it automatically for you. If that sounds interesting, I'm actually going to give a demo of an early version of this feature at the Lightning Demos tomorrow afternoon. So be sure to see that. So once we make progress integrating editor services into the ISE, I'm going to try to wire up as many of these language features as possible because the ISE doesn't have a lot of these things. So we'll see if we can get some of these things actually built into the ISE. So editor services interactive console experience is getting better with each release, even though it isn't immediately visible within VS Code. We're able to do interactive script execution and have a console experience which supports custom prompt functions just like the ISE. It even provides choice and input prompt support either through the interactive console or natively through the editor's UI. So in VS Code, if you run a command that causes a choice prompt to appear, you actually will see a little drop down that gives you the options in VS Code's command palette rather than it just showing up in the command console. So this can be helpful for like nicer integration with the editor for various reasons, like if you have an extension or something. It's also, if you type in a command that you haven't filled in all the mandatory parameters for, you need to be able to get prompted for those things. So we also have the input prompt support where this will show up in the UI. And I also just finished adding dollar profile support, which should show up in the next release of the VS Code extension. For those of you who aren't familiar with profile scripts, they are used to customize your PowerShell session in a given host, like the ISE or VS Code. You can do things like load modules, create commonly used functions, set your preferred command aliases, define your custom prompt function, stuff like that. This feature is really the most helpful whenever you are using an interactive console from within an editor. So, you know, just to make it a little bit more, you know, customized for your purposes. We're only lacking a couple of important features at this point, but I intend to have them done before we hit version 1.0 later on this year. The first is the ability to accept credentials securely. And that's only missing because we haven't yet found a secure way to securely transmit the credentials you type from the editor to the language service. So since we have this model where, you know, the editor is talking to the language service through some channel, we want to make sure that once you type in credentials in the editor, that they're secured in the editor as well as in across the channel to get to the language service. This is a little bit difficult, especially in VS Code, because it's a web-based application, and if anyone is sufficiently intelligent or crafty enough, they could probably intercept the things that you're typing in, but I think that's just a general problem anyway. But that's sort of why that's missing at this point. The other thing is support for remote and nested sessions. This is something that we just need to have time to do. It's not very hard to achieve. So probably within the next 2 to 3 months, you'll see remote session support in the ISE so that you can connect to like a nano server for script editing, debugging, that sort of thing. We also provide a pretty rich local script debugging experience. You can set breakpoints on lines, commands, and arbitrary expressions. You can also inspect the variables at each level of the call stack. Our interactive console experience also extends to the debugger, and which allows you to run commands while you're stopped at a breakpoint. So if you want to run some of the PowerShell's debugging commands, or if you want to sort of mess around with the values of variables in the running script, you can do that. Keith Hill has done a ton of work to improve the debugging experience that we're able to provide. So if you've never tried out the debugging experience in VS Code, you should give it a shot and then tell Keith thank you whenever it blows your mind, because it's pretty cool. So there's some other nice features that the platform provides, and we've designed them in a way that allows you to only use the ones that you care about if you're trying to integrate this with an editor. First of all, our APIs are designed in a layered model where the core functionality is exposed through a set of classes which are usable in any .NET application. So basically, you can just pull a NuGet package into your app and, you know, I don't know, 20 lines of code, and you're set up and you're able to run commands and use some of these nice editor features. The next layer above that provides a way to host these APIs in a process which communicate with non-.NET applications through any channel. For now, this host process speaks Visual Studio Code's JSON-based language and debug server protocols. And it does it over standard input, standard output. So basically, VS Code launches the process and disconnects to the console in, console out, and we're basically communicating with JSON messages back and forth that way. But we can also plug in different protocols. It doesn't necessarily have to be a JSON protocol. It could be something else. And I might experiment with this a little bit in the future. This also implies that the API can be exposed both to other processes on the same machine or through a network-based channel like HTTP. Adam Driscoll has helped get the ball rolling on providing a WebSocket support to make the JSON protocol available as a web service that could be used either on the same machine or possibly a remote machine. Once we have a chance to flesh out the support and add the appropriate WebSocket client in VS Code, then it would allow the users of code editors like VS Code on OS X and Linux to edit their code from OS X, but have all the language features coming from a host app that's running within a Windows VM or potentially like a service running in the cloud. So it would give you the ability to do PowerShell development with full features on those OSs without actually running PowerShell locally on the OS, since we don't have it. But there's a lot of possibilities here, so there's a lot of different ways to integrate this into other things. So definitely some interesting things we could do. Another useful feature is PowerShell Gallery integration. This allows any editor to interact with the PowerShell Gallery to list, install, and manage PowerShell modules from any gallery repository. So not just the standard PS Gallery. Doug Fink helped to get the support started, and I'm going to leverage the new code that you saw in the ISE preview for doing module updates to sort of put that together into editor services to provide like a standard service for interacting with the PowerShell Gallery. And lastly, we'll be providing a new extensibility model, which will enable editor commands to be written in PowerShell and to be used across all the editors that leverage editor services. You'll be able to automate things in the editor like editing text or launching actions in the editor or maybe changing views. We sort of have to figure out what the common surface area is across different editors, but this might be a pretty interesting way for people to use their existing PowerShell code for their modules to provide new editor functionality. So that's a pretty interesting thing. So this feature is actually currently in development, but it's in like very early stages. So I've got a short demo that I'll show you today about to give you an idea what is possible with this. So I'm going to show you how this looks in Visual Studio Code. So let me see if I can make this a little bigger. too big. Anyway, so what you see here is a file that I have open. And I have a function I've defined, which does just really simple thing, where it just writes output. And you see this commandlet here, this if I can find my mouse, this register editor extension. And basically, this command is running your PowerShell session, and it says, I want to register a new command in the editor with this display name of my command with function, and also this ID, which is useful maybe to identify the command from other areas. Also, you're saying basically that there's a function called invoke my command, which is this, which should be invoked whenever the command is launched. So to access these commands, I'll go to the show additional commands from PowerShell modules option. And if I run that right now, it tells me that no extension commands have been loaded into the current session, which is what we expect. So what I'll do is I will select this code. And I'll run it with F8. You'll see in the output console that I've actually ran the code and the command has been registered. And now if I go back to that same additional commands list, you'll see that my command with function now shows up. So if I run that, you'll see that the right output is actually called, and basically just invoke my function directly. And it's kind of nice because you can actually edit these things in real time and not have to like restart your editor to be able to see the updated functionality. So now we can also do the same thing with script block. So if I have another command registered here, or able to be registered, which actually just takes a script block and writes output as well. I've run that one, and now let's go to the additional commands list. And now we see my command with script block is here. So run that, same output. So that's pretty basic, not really helpful. You know, you could do things like run git process or something, but maybe you could launch your build scripts or maybe a deployment script. That can be kind of helpful, but the real helpful stuff comes when you start actually manipulating the editor in real time. So I've defined this function called invoke my edit. And it accepts this context variable. And this is a variable that comes from PowerShell Editor Services. And it gives you information about the current context of the editor at the time the command was invoked. So we have things like the current file. And we have information about like what the current user selection is and where the cursor location is in the buffer. So this current myEdit function actually will take the current file and will insert text into the file. And it will do it with the sort of the full range of the current file, meaning the entire file. So we're basically saying insert this string with this entire range. So it basically overwrites the range that you've specified. So if I just type something like, whoops, and I run this, then I can go and type, whoops, additional commands. And then apply my edit is available. So if I hit that, and it basically just replaces the entire buffer. So that's kind of cool. I mean, another thing you can do is you know, do some manipulation to the actual content that's already here. So if I take this and say context.currentFile.contents.toUpper. And all I have to do at this point, since the command's already registered, is just reevaluate the function itself. And if I run it, it basically uppercases everything in the file. So you can start to see where this can go. You can just basically manipulate the code in place. So let's say if I wanted to actually insert some text into the file. So let me comment this line out and uncomment these two lines. So what I'm doing here is I'm actually creating an object that defines the range that I want to update. This is not the actual desired way that I want people to do this. I'll provide some overloads to this insert text method, but for now I'm just doing it this way. So basically what I want to do is in the current file, I want to insert a line of text at, let's see if I can get it to the end here, at the line 24, column 1, and line 24, column 1. So that's like the start location and end location. So basically I'm saying at this cursor location, I want to insert this piece of text. So if I go and reevaluate this function, then I should be able to run it, and now it inserts this new line of text here. So I'm basically going to format my C drive, which is nice. But anyway, hopefully that shows you that we basically can do lots of stuff with this. One thing that you could do is have a command for your project where you automatically are able to insert comment block headers for your files, or maybe you know, generate a certain type of function. Like if you have a lot of code that needs to be generated for your project, you could easily generate it using one of these commands. Yep.
Where's your plan of this like going? Like, I mean, are you thinking like in your profile, or will that command register and just stay only for the session?
That's a great question. So one way is it could go in your profile. Another thing that I'm thinking is, it would be great if there was a way that if a PowerShell module from the gallery included something that registers a command like this, if we could actually identify that module as having a command and load it automatically in the session, if you have maybe a command in your profile that says automatically load extensions. Maybe the way that happens is we have like an extra tag we put on, that it's like a conventional tag we put on modules in the PowerShell gallery. So I can just do like grab all the modules that have this command that you have, or this tag that you have that are installed, and just load them up. For a person who writes a module who wants to actually add some extension commands in from their module, they can just check to see if the PS editor object is available, and if so, they can just call the register command function. So I think it's going to be a little bit of both. Either people have their own sort of common code that they are going to run for registering commands, or modules that you get from the gallery will have extension commands that will be able to run whenever they're loaded into your session. So does that answer the question?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I kind of want this to be the new way going forward of providing new functionality to editors. The nice thing about this is that for an editor who wants to provide the same extensibility, they just need to implement a few methods on an interface, or potentially respond to a few different messages in the JSON protocol for the host process. So should be available anywhere that the editor services is used, which is pretty cool. So. The first draft of this extensibility model is going to show up in version 0.6, the next version of the VS Code extension. And I expect it'll show up in the ISE preview probably within the next 2 to 3 months. I'm going to do a little bit of work to get that started in the ISE preview for my next talk at the PSConf EU. But it probably won't be fully there yet before, you know, I ship the next version of the ISE preview.
I got one more question.
Yep.
With the ISE, how do you intend to get the same functionality of, you know, it doesn't have that little bar where you type
right.
commands and stuff.
Right. Another great question. Yeah, that's another one of the things I want to add to the ISE preview, is that same kind of command palette construct. So for people who haven't really used VS Code very much, VS Code has this really cool command palette where it basically gives you every single command that's available in the editor. And you can type something like save, and it will show you the save commands. It also shows you the key binding for the command. So I would like to add something like that for the ISE, because I think that it gives a way to surface all of the possible operations that are in the editor, and allows you to add your own operations at the same level as the built-in operations, so that, you know, all of the functionality that's in the editor currently is all sort of at the same level, and it should be pretty helpful. But definitely curious to hear if people think that's a bad idea, or if they like it. But
I would like to see that.
Yeah. There's a lot of people on Twitter. I did a Twitter poll maybe 2 months ago or something, asking if people wanted to see it, and generally, people seem to be in favor of it, so I'm going to give it a shot, and if people don't like it, ultimately, I can take it back out, but I think it'll be helpful. Let's see. So in my mind, the future of the PowerShell authoring experience is clear. Our short-term goal will be to use the integration of PowerShell editor services into the ISE preview as a way to flesh out its feature support, so that the same functionality can be used in many other places. This should help make developer adoption of PowerShell go a lot more smoothly, because developers can use the tools that they already like, you know, their editors that they already like, to have a really good PowerShell development experience. They don't have to go and learn, you know, VS Code or the ISE or Visual Studio if they don't want to. I'd also love to work with anyone who's interested in using PowerShell editor services in a code editor or any other type of application. The project is open for contributions and any other type of feedback on GitHub. So if you just go check out our GitHub page, which I'll show a link to later, then you'll be able to see all the things that are happening. If you watch the repo, you'll see all the work in progress. Usually it's just me and Keith talking on issues. And the platform will get so much better with every new contribution and integration. So any amount of interaction there is definitely helpful. So lastly, I want to mention that we need volunteers for a usability study tomorrow at 4:30 p.m. So this is right after the lightning demo session. We need about 20 to 30 people to participate in a UI study for a possible new feature for Windows Server. It's like a prototype that I've been working on. We are looking mainly for beginner to intermediate people with PowerShell, but advanced users are welcome. You know, it doesn't matter if you're MVP or not. If you're not an MVP, you can sign an NDA there. And if you're interested in joining, please talk to me or Mark Gray, who's a PM on the PowerShell team, to sign up, and we'll let you know more details tomorrow about what room it'll be in, that sort of thing. So thank you very much for coming to my talk. Here are some details about myself on Twitter and GitHub, and also the link to PowerShell Editor Services on GitHub as well. I think we have a little bit of time for questions, if anybody wants to ask questions. All good?
So for VS Code, I mean, in addition to VS Code extension itself, do I need to grab the PowerShell Editor Services?
It comes bundled with the VS Code extension. So whenever you install the extension through VS Code's extension installer, it has everything you need there. So yeah, so basically it's a .NET application that is bundled and just gets launched with the extension.
Okay. When did the interactive shell get there? Last time I checked the code out, it wasn't.
Yeah, so it's been there for maybe two or three releases. It's sort of hidden because you can't actually type directly in it. It's actually an output pane where if you select some code and hit F8, it will run it and show the output. Yeah, so the sort of hacky way to deal with that for now is to just type something, not format volume, obviously, but like git process and hit F8 and it will give you the output. But
will F8 just select the current line?
F8 runs whatever you currently have selected. I think somebody added the function where this is not actually selected, this is highlighted. I think if you don't have a selection, it runs the current line. Yeah, okay. But I don't know why it failed at that point. It runs up to where the cursor is. That's a little weird. But anyway, yeah, so what we're waiting on is for VS Code to add the console so that we can basically just wire this directly into a console where you can type in commands. So that's coming. I think that within the next couple of months it'll be there.
Yeah,
so
that would definitely change my whole view on.
Yeah. That's like the one thing that's missing, I think, until this is like way better. But anyway, I think we're out of time. So thank you very much for coming.